team, family, squadron. Let that sink in. There's something special in the air today. We're lucky, privileged, blessed, and honored to be joined by one of my all-time favorite people, one of my most loved, one of my most cherished friends. I don't know what I'd do without this guy. We've got our VP of marketing, Jake Reedy. So excited to take a deep dive into this guy's brand. I think we all are. But as for right now, welcome out to yet another episode of The Landing Pad.
Intermission, let the birds fly. I get money, turn no vision through my third eye. Money, don't let skill it, watch me flip it like it's five guys. Flip it, right there, bro, check out the ceiling, look at the blue skies. I took a tip, check, yeah, but we can sit on my lip. I don't regret, yeah, I'm betting I don't got a jet. You crawl for you wall, you can't ball every week. All my dogs, hello, wrong, we gon' ball like the world. Hey now, you're an all-star, get your
game on, go play. Jacob Reedy, welcome to The Landing Pad.
Thank you for having me, Garthy.
Oh, hey. Feels so right. I remember you used to be obviously in the other chair where Mark is now sitting. You've listened to many, many a Landing Pad. It just was, made sense for you to be on and share your wisdom, shed some light on all of our listeners. So thank you for being here.
You're welcome. You guys always promised, you know, I'd be here. I didn't think you were serious.
Oh, no. We come through. We deliver.
We were serious.
The pad delivers.
Always. So, Jake, we are so happy to have you on here. But, hey, let's, before we get into the good stuff, let's go through rapid fire grit news really fast. This stuff, when this podcast drops in 2 weeks, all of this stuff will have happened in the past. So, super quick recap. Hopefully, the Grail Jam or the Grit Rail Jam was a huge success. At this point,
it was fun, dude.
It was way fun.
Was that not crazy, dude?
Favorite event we've ever done,
dude. Travis Scott, when he signed my, he gave me all those shoes and dabbed me up. I got his number. Like, it, that was so sick.
I don't know.
The All Star Game.
So the All Star Game was
All Star Weekend.
That was awesome. It was
in
great.
Conjunction with the Jazz. Yeah, it's gonna be. In all seriousness, listening to this, I hope you're thinking of the Grill Jam and are looking back and saying, "Wow,
that was
awesome. Cannot believe they helped put on that event."
Yeah, and obviously Jake being such a huge piece of the branding of it, the execution of it. So if you had a good time, this is one of the main guys to thank and to be grateful for. So All Star Game is hopefully sick. So there are right currently there's a group of about 100 people on our charity trip. I am actually taking off tomorrow for the second group. For another 5 days to Ecuador. From the looks of it, it looks like it's been going awesome. It looks like those guys have had an awesome time. They're fixing up one school, so they're taking 10 days on this one school. It's looked awesome. Obviously, we'll be able to return and report on the next episode of exactly how it went down, but I think it's a huge success, and everybody is absolutely loving it. So that is it for the great news.
Not a lot of news. We wanted to make sure we cleared the schedule for our friend here.
Yep. Now, Jake, would you mind if we did a new segment sponsored by Grit Marketing called Rapid Fire, Would You Rather?
Yeah, I mean,
I wonder what the segment is.
do you
At
consent?
The end of the day, I'm on the team that edits stuff and can edit out whatever, so.
Let's do it.
I don't see
Easton, will you do the honors of doing the first one? These are rapid fire.
Yep. Would you rather have one real get out of jail free card or a key that opens any door?
Oh, get out of free. Yeah, that's not even hard. There are so many things that just Jay is just that I don't do because of jail.
Yeah, fair.
That's what we arrived at after like 10 minutes of talking. Okay, next up. Would you rather know the history of every object you touched or be able to talk to animals?
Dang, dude. I mean, I already have the talk to animals thing a little bit.
Yeah.
But I'm going to say I want it more because there's some animals that I don't have access to at this point. So I'd do that. I mean, that's tough, though. That's a great question.
Okay.
Isn't that nuts? You pick up some rock by the beach and you get transported back to dinosaurs? Really?
Wow. Dude,
yeah, you know that rock's history?
That's crazy. Yeah.
You were talking about going to Jerusalem and seeing the guy himself. Yeah,
but I'm telling you, dude, you could do it all.
I think animals have more of a message, though, that's not coming through. So
it's fair.
Than a rock?
It's honestly fair.
Okay, next up. Would you rather go back to age 5 with everything you know now or know everything your future self will learn? Now.
I have to relive the life in the first one?
Yes.
I'd do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you'd just be a prodigy, dude. You'd be a prodigy.
Yeah, phenom.
I mean, to have to wait, do the math, 18 minus 5 years to like kiss a girl is tough.
Yeah.
Because you'd still have the taste and, you'd still be like trying to date, but you're six.
Yeah. Something like that.
You're trying to tell your parents, you're like, I can drive.
I've tried it before.
You don't get it. Like, I can do it.
Yeah. Invest in this Google thing, this Uber thing.
Oh, yeah.
Last one. Would you rather be an average age person in the present, an average person in the present, or a king of a large country 2,500 years ago?
Oh, king of a large country.
Yeah.
That one's easy.
Yeah. I concur.
You think so?
But, dude, not really. Like, I just don't know enough. I don't know enough. What are they like? What are you actually doing for fun, though? Do they have fun?
I don't know. You know that you have like thousands of people. You could be like, I would treat it like an art thing. I'd be like, I'm thinking of a cool monument.
Just force them to do it.
Well, I'd hook them up with breaks.
Yeah, they have breaks, Garth.
Like, I would offer fruits and breaks.
You'd be a good ruler.
But there'd be a lot of cool. Like, there'd be greater things that would have been built for our time.
If you were.
And right. I'm doing it for our time.
For the future.
Yeah.
Wow. I love that.
It's a well-oiled answer.
That was a segment of Would You Rather, sponsored by Grit Marketing. Let's get into it. Easton.
If that doesn't give you a flavor for how this podcast is going to go, yeah, we're taking up permanent residence outside the box for the next 40 minutes. That's where we're at.
Mm-hmm.
So, Jake, just getting right into it, and I feel like I'm trying to be as non-biased as I possibly can, getting right into the question. And then, obviously, we're not doing a background because I kind of want to get into your background as we ask the questions. But I feel like I'm trying to be as non-biased as I humanly possibly can. And I feel like regardless of who you're talking to, the Grit's branding, marketing, and identity is like a pillar of excellence in the industry and just as a whole. And so my question is, to get things started, what is the key to creating, crafting, making a successful brand or identity? Like, where does it start?
Yeah. I think it has to do with like understanding your identity, and just being able to reflect that and realizing that there's no template, but the more like you can, you make it reflect who you are and your identity. Everybody's interesting, and every culture, especially every group of people, has its own identity. And so making it the most you is going to be the most interesting thing to do. I think a lot of people approach it with a template and they say, oh, I like the way that this identity is, or this brand is doing it. So we work with MFG, and we did early when I came on, we paid for a whole branding, consultation, and they helped us a ton with that because Josh Nilsson and I have a lot, but we didn't have a lot of the history and background to do that. And so since then, David over at MFG has told me, he's like, people will come to me, other sales organizations, and say, hey, can you guys give us kind of like what you did for the Grit? Like, we like how that looks and feels.
Yeah.
And David not only says no, because like, why would we want to just have another one, but he says no, because you can't just fake that. He's like, even if I gave you that, you wouldn't be able to uphold it and keep it going or really do it, because that's not who you are. So rather than do that, it's like, who are you? Are you, and you look at the Grit's brand, and it's like the font is like Helvetica. It's the most simple font. Our people aren't like the most sophisticated people ever. It's like it's an accessible font, but it's like how it's treated, and it's the intensity, and it's the grittiness in which that font is treated. And so it's like, mostly to answer your question, it's like, well, who are you? And that's really, it's a bunch of research on who you are and what your values are.
When MFG came, because I remember, right, they sat down, they did interviews. What for you was the, when they were there doing the analysis, what stood out to you as the most interesting thing that they did in order to find the identity, the identity of the brand, of the Grit? What stuck out to you the most?
I mean, they just listened, what I think everyone on our end was skeptical about of like having a third party come in is being like, well, they're just going to do what they like and what they're interested in. And this, the references that they're interested in.
Yeah.
But when they came, it was like 2 weeks of interviews where they didn't say a thing. It was collecting data. They did, you know, one-on-ones. I think you were in some of those meetings. And they just asked and they listened. And it's like, you know, and then looked at the history and worked with what we had been doing that was a little bit more all over the place, but like really got like, okay, what is this? And so I think that's the coolest thing, right? Like the most interesting they did was just like listen and then start to build upon it.
Ethan, what do you remember some of the questions that they asked you? Do you remember?
Yeah, it was a lot of like what the grit means to you. If you had to define the grit in one word, I thought the most interesting question, I hope I get it right, is if you had to define the grit as one celebrity or athlete, who would you pick? And I remember the answers being all across the board, but once I started hearing MFG and then like Jake and Josh Quickly Adopted talking about branding like that, like if you were to summarize in summation, what would our brand be? At least I felt even just as a sales rep, manager, whatever, I started viewing the brand in way different ways. So I just thought MFG came in, and obviously with the help of the creative team and then the direction of everyone over there, I just thought it was so comprehensive. I remember seeing the slide deck and was wowed.
Yeah.
Because it's they put examples of other work that they've done with other companies, and you look, and the branding of Aptive versus the branding of us doing relatively the same thing is night and day. Now, granted, like you could do a couple of cool things because we're not as customer facing as a lot of the other competitors in the space. But that being said, still, I think the truest thing that Jake said is there has to be alignment in who you are versus like who you're promoting that you are. And you could front and you could put on really whatever you want to. It's not that someone isn't capable of going and replicating, at least to an extent, a lot of the content that we put out. But the cultural, I don't even know the word, phenomenon that allows it to like have legs and go is what Jake is talking about. Yeah. It's the environment. I just think what Jake is saying is worth its weight in gold, because there has to be some degree of alignment. Otherwise, you're not going to have the legs to take it anywhere.
Yeah. I actually want to go over Jake's background right now. That way people can totally understand the guy that's talking to us. Right, Jake? And correct me if, you know, some of the stuff is off. Originally from good old Holiday. Born and raised Holiday.
Hollywood.
From there, middle school, in and out of treatment centers, kicked out of schools, right? Like you didn't, your upbringing wasn't just like easy, right? It wasn't middle school, high school, college, now you're here. Like you actually had, more of a history in high school. Like you had a youth that wasn't necessarily easy.
But it was fun. I mean,
good time. I'm not saying it wasn't a good time. background in graffiti, right? So that probably explains some of the times you were in and out of school. Yep. painting, drawing lessons growing up. You went to the School of Art at the Institute of Chicago. You then served a mission. Hey, I love to hear that. In the great New York City. You went to UVU with a psychology undergrad. In 2016, you actually went out and knocked the doors with good old Josh Nilsson.
Cleveland,
Ohio.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Best rookie in the office, right?
Second to Freeman Butler. We were toe-to-toe for a minute, but he came through.
Some OG names getting thrown around right now.
Happy Kelly, you know.
Yeah, but you did well. Funny enough, you ended up buying your first house with the back end. Mm-hmm. I love that. Claremont Graduate University with a master's in organizational behavior. So you ended up getting your master's. Your dad's just so proud of you, dude. Look at you. You went from zero to hero. What a guy.
Yeah. I mean, he doesn't wait. He's happy if I'm happy. He wouldn't care if I am.
We'll touch on this last piece. You reluctantly joined the grit, right? Thanks to good old Josh Nielsen. Mm-hmm. And you put here, it was the best decision ever, right? So what I love about Jake is, we didn't just hire a guy that graduated from BYU marketing program, right? We didn't just pick somebody that checked all the boxes. I remember when we were like talking about you, right? When Josh was like selling us like, dude, Jake, he's so talented. My thing, and actually I want you to touch on this for a second. I was just like, well, does he know how to like do video? And then he's like, oh, he could figure it out. I'm like, well, Josh, you could figure it out, dude. Like, I think we need somebody that actually like has hard skills. And Josh is like, no, dude, Jake gets it. He's so smart. Obviously ended up being possibly one of the best hires that we've ever made. And like you have taken the brand and you've done wonders with it, obviously with the whole team that we've got. But I just thought that it was so interesting that Josh was so passionate about hiring you. Mm-hmm. And maybe you could even speak on why hire you versus somebody that does check all the boxes.
Yeah, I think it's, it was a risk. I'm not saying that you guys, you know, there's good outcomes and there's good decisions. I don't even want to say that it was the best decision-making decision because it was such a risk and it wouldn't always pay off to hire someone who doesn't have the skills in place because it's harder. But I do think that there is such value in seeing, okay, no, like what is the, and I think that I definitely had a track record of like, you know, mastery in different mediums, whether it's, you know, visual art or, you know, like dabbling in video or murals or whatever it was, enough to know. But I think that like, for sure, it's, I would much rather hire taste than to hire skill. There's this concept, it's the gap. And, Ira Glass talks about it. There's like a 5-minute video on YouTube. Look up the gap, Ira Glass. But he talks about how the gap is like in between where you are and where you want to be. And that there's a lot of pain felt there, but that's a good thing because if, you know, the more pain you feel, that's just knowing that you can get there. And the thing to close that gap is just iterating, you know, but if there is a bigger gap, that means that this person has like good taste, you know, because if they're satisfied with where they're at, then they probably are, they don't have like a vision to look forward to. And so I think I would always much rather hire for taste because someone who has good taste is going to iterate until they can get there. So,
now having as VP of marketing, now having more say in like the hiring process, firing process, managing process of now like a full blown creative team. It's not just you locked with Mark, yeah, locked in the lab, mm-hmm, with Josh making it happen. Like that same barometer, that same principle of taste first, is that largely guiding a large portion of how you manage and hire?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's like we get, for video, for example, there's so many talented videographers in Utah. You know, maybe it's the outdoors or I don't know what it is that facilitates people having access to filming things and cameras in their hand. And they have friends that are, you know, BMXers or skiers. And so there's a lot of opportunity for that. But it's not enough to me if someone can handle a camera. It's like, okay, well, who inspires you? And then if I can see in that, you know, that to me is enough. If I see a list of someone who sends me like an inspiration or like who they like, that is just like really mind blowing. I'm like, we're on the same page. And especially in the modern day, right? It's like when Instagram first came out, like you were rewarded for production quality. Like a good photographer is a beautiful, someone who creates a beautiful photo. Mm-hmm. Or even video. It was like a high production, you know, high production value video is like enough. But now it's like you look at TikTok and it's loose. It's people that get rewarded and they're good at telling stories. They're good at like creating, sharing a spirit of something, and it can be with an iPhone. And so it's a totally different time. And to me, that's like, that's great if you can use a DSLR and like put a dubstep video over, like, like that's not what we're looking for, you know?
Super sick that you put Indian Summer over your Lake Powell video. Very, very cool.
Which at one point would have made us cry, right?
Dude, 2012 was a crazy time. We were just talking about it.
Yeah.
Because that being said, I look at the team that you guys have put together now with Bobby, Marco, Damon, Taylor, obviously with Mark as well. And you guys, like, everyone is so skilled, but yeah, they just have such good taste. And it's been so cool to be able to see what they were even doing before. I love like hearing that, like, Bobby, what was Bobby doing? Like designing billboards or something? And like
he worked at like signs.com.
Yeah. And like Taylor was doing, he worked at FedEx. And
but Bobby was also, we got to give
he worked
him
with, he did work with Rare Roses.
He worked with Rare Roses.
Yeah. Yeah. So. It's like, okay, there's that. But then Damon was doing like product shoots for like Facebook Marketplace. Like it's so cool that these guys get it. But with your help and obviously with Josh and Mark, you guys have been able to help them totally discover that they are so, so, so talented and can do so much. So I think it's been so fun to watch.
Yeah. No, it's such an opportunity. I can't believe that the curation that has come with my role, and it's because I know there's so much talent in Utah, but there's not always that much money going towards these people that are that talented. And so to be able to be like, hey, do you want a real job where you can do things that like are projects that you'd want to work on? To like, I love being able to offer that, you know? And yeah, to be able to curate that. And our team is just, yeah, out of control.
It's awesome. The next question that we wanted to talk about, kind of going back to brand a little bit, and we kind of talked about this a little bit, but if you can expand, in your opinion, right? Because you've been in the space now for a while, like a couple of years with us with The Grit, and obviously you've been following with Josh and all the other pest control companies and door-to-door companies. What would you say is the most common misstep in brand creation when these companies are trying to create their identity or do whatever they're doing?
Yeah, I mean, kind of like before, I think it's just like using a template or getting stuck in like what it has been. You know, it's like, I think like when Vivint came up, they were like, cool. And it was new. It was like, oh my gosh, they're putting so many resources into like their gear, like what their clothing and their gear and their brand. And it was cool. But then that kind of, you know, then everyone kind of started to do that. And there was like, then this like very concrete thing of like what a door-to-door sales company looked and felt like. And, you know, even from like the people who produced their clothing and who produce, you know, the people that, where they have their events, you know? And so, I think that, you know, one thing that Ben said, and, Ben Egan said, he's like, and Ben has great taste, and he's like, I want to make some, you know, door-to-door summer sales cool again. And I think that that's kind of a goofy thing, but I do like that concept of being like, no, like at the end of the day, it's not like, like it's just a group of people with like a unique, you know, identity, and it doesn't have to look like anything else. Like what is it? And so that's the way I approach it. And I think a lot of my art school friends would be like, they're probably like, oh, Jake's selling out. I'm like, no, you know,
yeah.
Like this is, I'm just serving a group of people that I love, and we are whatever we want to be, you know, we're not like tied to this whole thing. It doesn't have to look like anything else. And so, yeah,
I think that's so the concept of like, oh, Jake is selling out. I think the point of a lot of like innovation and trailblazing is disrupting. And yeah, a lot of people associate, in my opinion, look like outside looking in to like the creative community, I think a lot of people associate disrupting a space or doing something that's super non-traditional with just like no structure. You're pretty much like a vigilante trying to like break the mold on your own. When in reality, I really do think we're disrupting the space in a huge way, in the way that like we're marketing, branding, promoting our identity, but we're just doing it in a way like strategic, organized way. And so, I don't know, the idea of like, oh, we're selling out, or Jake's gone corporate. I don't know. If we were doing things as traditional and like we were rolling out the Lulus and we were rolling out like the flat brims, I'd be like, oh.
Yeah, mate. Okay.
Yeah,
mate,
yeah, Jake might have sold out. But yeah. I just don't see that as the case. Like I really do see the mission of the creative team and the mission of the identity of The Grit as like, how many trails can we blaze?
Yeah.
How hard can we innovate? How hard can we push this envelope? Which is why I think we found success.
Yeah. Jake, where do you feel like you see yourself in the brand, in the Grit brand?
I mean, I think it's hard to like separate, right? I think, but I mean, early on, like I always want to, if I do something, I want it to be, have this like spark of excitement.
Yeah.
Now it's hard to, that I said it's hard to separate me because I think that Mark and Josh and I have that as well. Like, but I think that there's, you know, whether it's a video, you know, right when I came on, I was like asked to do a top 10 video. And I used an AI for Ben Shapiro's voice.
Oh, yeah.
And I typed in a transcript and it sounds like it's Ben Shapiro.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, like, and this is top 10 for The Grit, like for this past week. And people were like, how much did you have to pay Ben Shapiro to do a top 10 like video for you? And so like that level of excitement, that spark of like seeing a response is like, But it is hard to separate. I mean, because, you know, I think that everyone on our team has that, really.
Yeah.
but I and we help each other push it forward. I mean, like we had a Christmas party planned last year, and it's hard to get these things in motion. So there was an event space booked, and Mark and Josh and I went to look at this space, and it was like you had to like walk through like a dentist office foyer to get there. And I felt this deep feeling of depression, and we'd paid for it. And then we were like, we cannot, this is not us. This is not our brand. And then Mark, we were like, what is this space? And then Mark had this idea. He's like, well, I'm connected with this guy that owns, you know, an ice skating rink. And we were like, a Christmas party. We got to do it on the ice. Granted, we didn't tell people to dress warm enough. There were some cold people, but overall, look at the video. The vibes were out of control at that. And then we could look back and be like, this is who we are, this, you know, but that is like how our team approaches it for sure.
Yeah, no, that sounds very on brand. Yeah. Just some people uncomfortable. I mean, it's not too different from choking down a Chick-fil-A chicken biscuit at 6:30 somewhere on the East Coast about to rumble.
Yeah.
And you're running off 4 hours. It's really the same. Being cold on the ice, doing the rest, it's all the same.
Yeah.
My question on the same like line that we've been talking about, identity and culture and so on and so forth, what do you think the unique challenges are to being in the summer sales door-to-door industry as far as creating a brand?
I think it's just, I mean, for one, hearing people talk a bit, like acting like we talked about as if it's doesn't have value, like, oh, you're working with this corporate thing. And then another one is like, it is just, again, just stripping it away and being like, okay, how can we approach this in a way that no one ever has? And closing your, putting blinders on to what other people are doing. And which has such a strong identity, pre-existing identity, and being like, no, who are we? And putting those blinders on so that you're not doing what other people have. And that causes a lot, that's a lot more, it's a very difficult way to approach it, you know, with our partners, whether it's the Jazz, like we've got to be the company that asks for the most, you know, and is the most needy, because we're like, even with the Grail Jam, they're like, we want to offer you guys to be the presenting sponsor, and we're going to give you exclusive access. That's part of it. And your name on the thing. And we're like, well, I'm sure a lot of people would love that offer, but like, we want to help.
We want more.
Plan this whole thing. We want a lot of, you know, and so, it's definitely more complicated there, you know, in just sourcing our clothing, for example, or sourcing whatever it is. It's a lot more difficult to do it the way we do it. And that's a big reason why people don't. It's like a lack of knowledge, and it's also just harder.
My follow-up question to that is, for everything that we've done up to this point, is there one particular moment or time when like you really saw all of this coming together and you're like, wow, this like identity and brand that we've been slaving away on is like really starting to culminate into something like that's wowing?
I mean, no, cause I think from day one, it's been like, even though it was like in a more chaotic way, to get a response and to be like, to see the comments and it's like who made this video, or like whoever put the song on it, like, and that's like impacted a smaller scale. So I think from day one, it's been there, you know, but more recently when other people, what's exciting is like, we have to put grit on every piece of clothing. We like to put grit on every piece of clothing, but as we move forward, like we want to be able to just like not have to do that. And for people to look and be like, oh, I know what that is. That's grit. And so Easton, it's totally like we're on our way there. And I think we're getting more and more there. But like, when other people can recognize the essence and the feel of something, or like when someone puts out another video that like is kind of like a dupe of ours, you know, and then people in the comments that don't even work for us and they're like, oh, like credit grit for this concept, you know, that is little things like that where it's like we have an identity that's like that's felt.
I was hoping you would touch on that. It's the same thing as it's when MFG came into the branding, you asked the question, if Nike had a hotel, Like, what do you think that would look like? And I think Nike has an extremely strong brand. And so I could start thinking in my mind pretty quickly, like, oh, yeah, like, that's probably somewhat like what a Nike hotel would look like. Where I think we've had a lot of success is I think we're a really, really strong brand that happens to sell pest control. Just like Red Bull's a really, really strong brand and they just happen to sell energy drinks. Mm-hmm. Or Liquid Death is like a super strong brand that just sells water in a can. Mm-hmm. And now like they've branched into other things, and that's what having like a really elite brand I think gives you, is just more options.
Mm-hmm. 100%.
So. You're something about like when we were asked that question, we were also asked like, well, if the Grit was going to design a hotel, what would that look like? Back when we were answering this question back at North Star, I would have had a clue what our hotel would look like, right? I would not have an idea. The crazy thing is like 2 years down the road with what you guys have built, it's like I could actually kind of get an idea of like what, like as crazy as it would be, like a Grit hotel. I'm like picturing the lobby that you would walk in on. I'm picturing the rooms. Like I actually can see it where before 2 years ago, I don't know what I would have seen. There wasn't anything.
Boy, would I love to see that.
That'd be crazy.
That would be a haunted house.
You're taking a National Treasure style like wooden pulley to get to your room, and then then once you get in, everything is touchscreen. Yes. And you're just like, whoa! And like my room service came up on a domesticated tiger. I'm just blown away.
Exactly.
That's a carnival.
Yeah. So another question, kind of stayed on the same note with the brand. Jake, how do you continue to evolve the brand to keep up with the identity of the company? What would you say?
I mean, I think it's like, it has to do with being super in touch with people, you know, and I'm so grateful to be able to like be, it's so easy to be friends with everyone at Grit, you know?
Yeah.
And I love that people pop in and like, even sometimes people who shouldn't be having an opinion share it. And I appreciate that, you know what I mean? Cause I'm like, this is how we're doing. You know what I mean? This is the response and reaction. And so, I think that's like, that's a big part of it. And, it's just knowing and caring about and realizing that like it, part of it is like loving and serving the people. That's how I want to see it. It's not like, hey, we're over here in a room coming up with everything. And like, here it is. Hope you like it. It's like, no. These are all my friends. This is who we are. And then it's just intuitive after that, but just caring and realizing that like, we're trying to serve people with everything that we make. We're trying to entertain people. We're trying to like, inspire people. We're trying to like at events, like give people a meaningful connections. And so I think it's, just, knowledge, you know?
Yeah, no, and what I love about that, dude, it's true. Like the average age of the, you know, with the sales rep or even the employee at the Grit's probably 24, probably 23. And our corporate team probably, 23, 24. Mm-hmm. So it's so cool that there's no, I almost feel like there's zero disconnect or there's, you know, not a lot of light between the marketing team and like the sales reps, right? Like a lot of them wear the same clothes. A lot of them have the same hobbies. A lot of them, like Bobby could walk in and play a game of pool with anybody. And like, that would be so fun where it's like other companies, the marketing guy is 42. He's got four kids and he's trying to create content, trying to create clothing, trying to create a brand for a bunch of 22-year-olds. Like you guys do such a good job of capturing the vibes, the essence, the, you know, the, what's the word I'm looking for?
Just the identity of who we are.
Exactly.
It's really a difficult thing to like crystallize that and then be able to put it on merch and posts and top tens, mm-hmm. and rope in like this edgy, gritty, like like kind of off the wall branding to like golden doors and contract values and attrition. Tough. It's like, that's just hard to dress up and make sexy, but the way that they've done it is unreal.
One of my favorite quotes by Viktor Frankl, Man's Search for Meaning.
Mm.
Garth, you would love reading. You got to try it. It's like a whole.
It's a whole thing, dude.
Yeah, it takes a whole. It's like TV, but it's just like the transcript.
Okay. Yeah.
But he says you don't invent your mission in life. You detect it. And I really like that because it's like, and I think that way about everything. And I think that it has to do with there being more of a dialogue. You know, you don't just impose your, like what you want to do in life and just be like, in a vacuum. You know, it's like, what are, and I'm going to talk about it more in a life way, but it's like, what are my strengths and what are the needs of the world? And how do my strengths fill in and like manifest in the needs of others? And it like, and so same thing with branding. It's like, I don't think you invent your brand, you detect it, you know? Yeah. And there's always going to be a form of like collaboration with whoever's like designing or whatever, designing it and who the people are, but it's much more of a dialogue.
Yeah. And yeah, I love that. Jake, diving a little into your brain now, taking a step away from the branding of the grit, we want to understand who you are, right, as a creative. That being said, in the Jake Reedy Bible of creativity and creation, what would you say is the golden rule? Chapter 1, verse 1.
I think it's like, it's funny because it's become a theme over this, but it's that there's no template. I remember being like very, in the early days of like Instagram and VSCO, I remember like taking a photo and then throwing a VSCO filter on it and being like, this is the filter.
Presets,
I'm
going
to use this one.
You'd sell your presets for 10
and
bucks.
And then I remember like being like, this is it. Like it looks so good. And then taking another one, like throwing that same one on and be like, wait a second. Like you, like everything is different. Everything. And so talking about creativity, it's like, I think that creativity is just like being able to access information that's not like the first thing you would think about. So everyone, in that view, everyone is creative. It's just about, and some people are more like neurodivergent, so their neurons are like at the first, you know, response or jumping, you know, to like a random one. But and some people are more naturally that way. But at the end of the day, it's like, I think that everyone is creative, and what can you do to put yourself in spaces to meditate or to be able to say, okay, you know, like how can I explore not the first answer, the second answer, the third answer, but like the fifth, sixth, hundredth thing that I could think of in this situation. And so I think that like the first rule is just like giving myself space to ignore the first answer, whether it's like, for example, coming up with a trophy. You know, the first thing is like, you know, John's like, hey, we need trophies. Like we got these guys over here at trophies.com. They're going to do a thing. And it's like, okay, that'd be really easy, but let's pause. Like, what's the idea? Like, what is a trophy? You know, it's like, what's the purpose of a trophy? Like, what is the ritual of giving a trophy? And like, how can, and then being like, well, it's to celebrate someone in a meaningful way and give them like a symbol. It's like, okay, well, with that in mind, like, how could we make it like more meaningful than like this, like, you know, CNC cut, like trophies.com thing. And the, what we had for the gala is we like, you know, our ramping is a big thing. So we like, you know, Cole and Mark came over to my studio and we like sculpted a ramp and molded it in silicone and filled it with concrete. And then this concrete, like tech looking ramp thing, yeah, but it was really sick. Cool is the trophy. And so I think it's just like the golden rule is just being like, you know, go past the first thing you want to do, and that there's no template. Like there's no way, you know, there's no way to say what worked last time will work this time. It's approaching everything fresh.
That being said, though, we talked about this almost jokingly beforehand. Something that gets asked a lot of times in interviews to creatives is just, well, like what inspires you? What inspires you, man? And it's become an important question because that manifests itself in every medium that you put out to the public. But I think way more importantly, the question that I want to ask is if there's no template, if there's no approach, like there is a super, in my opinion, super important part of creativity that stems from what you're inspired by. Mm-hmm. If there's no approach and if there's no like formula, I go to this spot, I listen to this music, I do this thing, and then I'm like inspired. If there's no like foolproof way to do it, my question is like, how do you stay inspired?
Yeah. I mean, I think it's like knowing myself, you know, and I think it's like giving space because the day to day normal life is pretty mechanical. We have to wake up and go to the bathroom and eat and go to work and then have lunch. But it's like interrupting that and giving like space, like putting myself in spaces, to where I can like receive different information And it could get crazy hippie right now on this.
No, please.
Go, I so want you to
you
go
know,
there.
But I think
I'll
it's
take
like
my shoes and socks off.
Mine are already off.
Can I see them?
My feet? Yeah.
No, but I think it's like putting, I think it's like putting, put like creating spaces to where you can access information that's like, you know, closing out the noise. Like for me, it's like, I know that if I go on a run and then like at 3 miles, just like stop and pull out my journal, like the things that I like explore in that are going to be, they're going to be great. And I'm someone who also believes that like there are ideas, like the body is a vessel, and that there are ideas that are like floating out there around, and like it's our job to kind of catch them. And but in order to do that, you need to be sensitive and open to catching those. And so, but I know what my spaces are. I know what my things are. I know what my music is. I know what my time of day is to be able to like catch ideas, you know? And there's also an urgency, because I also believe that if you don't catch an idea, you know, it's going to go and find somebody else to do it. But the more sensitive you are, it's like you have first dibs to the good ideas, you know?
Dude, that is so good. My mind is literally opening. Like, you're talking about the trophies, right? And it's like, in my mind, when you're talking about trophies, I love what you said. It might not be the first answer, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. It could be the 74th, right? It's like, in my mind, first is the glass trophy. The second is the baseball bat. The third is a framed jersey. The fourth is this. Like, dude, yeah, I think that for me, I usually, because I'm not very creative, I'm like number one or two, right? Maybe if I think three or four, it's like semi-creative. But I'd love that you did that with the Christmas party. Well, you guys did that with the Christmas party. I love that you guys did that with the top 10 videos. It's so cool. And I love that you said, like, just put yourself out there. Don't take the first answer that comes to your head, because that's the first answer that usually comes to everybody. Mm-hmm. A trophy's a trophy. You know what I mean? A Christmas party is a Christmas party. A top 10 video is a top 10 video. A vacation to Mexico video, they're all the same.
Yeah.
Right. But being able to not take the first thing that comes to your head and be able to go, you know, riff off a little bit, go down the line, like think, allow the idea to come to you, and then be open to exploring tons of different stuff.
Yeah. And I think that like a huge part as well is like understanding intention. And it's funny that we had that thing about this podcast will come out later, right? So we had that mini dialogue about the grilling was sick. Funny enough is like in our team, that's what we do. Like Josh always starts his conversation before an event happens. He's like, dude, come with me on this journey. And he'd be like, this, you know, 3 weeks before, a month before the gala, he's like, man, like that was so incredible. Like, and he'll be like, Jake, like we're driving away right now of that night. What did we experience? You know, what did we feel? Like, what did we, and then we can go into the space of being like, of kind of talking about reverse engineering, you know, an event or whatever it was. And so being clear on intention is huge. And I think that we're all, that goes for the summer too. It's like, you know, you look at Zach Seeger's podcast, and he talks about, he reverse engineered his summer in that way, where he manifested before, and he listened to that thing. He's like, I did it. And I think that that's a super powerful tool that we use. Can be super important with every little thing you do. What's the intention, you know, and what is the overall feeling? And without intention, things can be hollow. You know, a trophy can be hollow. It can't, it's fine if it's like, if it is the vinyl cut thing or the baseball bat, but if it's coupled with that like meaningful, really true intention. But the closer you can get to like aligning the physical thing or the experience with like the real purpose of what you're trying to do, like the more meaningful that thing is going to be.
Real, in my opinion, this is what I love about our creative team. And I think they just, everyone on the team just gets us on such a high level. In my opinion, the things that like take our breath away, the things that like really move us, all they do is just exceed our expectations. And so I think it's directly tied. If you went with the first or second option of like the first thing that came to your mind, well, what is the other person expecting?
Yeah.
Probably the first or second or third thing that came to your mind as well. Mm-hmm. And so you're never really giving yourself a runway to actually wow or exceed the expectations of the consumer or the person who's taking in the content.
Yeah.
Literally just because you didn't take the time to go past what they were expecting anyways.
Mm-hmm.
But like all of a sudden you put a Christmas party on ice, or you make the award a ramp, or you do a Grail Jam indoors and like defy all the odds. Well, dude, that's not what people are expecting. Mm-hmm. People are expecting like a little get together, a powwow, or whatever. And dude, I just think the reason why so much of it is so moving and it's caught so much traction and has been so pivotal in our growth is just because people have expected one thing for a really long time. And we're just consistently exceeding. Could you imagine if we ended up settling on the first or second thing?
No, well, we wouldn't be where we are.
We never would have moved anyone. I don't think we would have ever exceeded any expectations. And I think
I don't think Jake would be here.
And
right?
I think our brand would have just largely fallen like by the wayside.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
My last question is this, Jake, and this is where we want to wrap up, conclude. Getting you to join the Grit was not an easy feat. To getting you to come work with us, be involved in the whole summer sales industry. But here we are almost 2 years later. In what areas have you seen yourself growing the most? And what are you most excited about moving forward?
That's a good question. I think I've definitely grown the most. I think I've had a ton of mentors, which has been one of the coolest parts about this job. You know, working with MFG is huge. David over there has been a great mentor. Lyman, who's now creative director at Empower, you know, it's cool to have people. And so I think, I think that like, I have this, I've always had this like raw kind of creativity, but the formalization of that is something that's like, you know, what is a creative person like who's just creative and doesn't have education or training? They're going to do cool things, but someone who's like, who is creative and open and interested in creating a new thing and building something special with an education, that's huge. And so a part of it has been a big education, you know. Looking forward, I think it's just like, it's a huge challenge to be like, okay, like, where do we go from here?
Yeah, what's next?
And talking about those ideas, right? I definitely like think that we have some on the creative team's end. It's like, there are some things like some forecasting that I won't talk about that I think that like, I think that there will be a few things that will, looking in 10 years that will be inextricably like a part of door-to-door sales companies. And it's just about like who gets there first. And that's really exciting to be like, those are big things, but like, how are we going to actually make them happen? And to have the clarity on my end to be like, I really believe that though. And to be like, how are we going to get there? But I would love to look back, whether I'm here or whether, you know, and to be like, yeah, I could totally see that coming. And I just hope to be like, you know, good enough to make it happen with the Grit. So. But it's fun. It's a fun space.
And I actually have one last question, Jake. For those that are listening, that you have now gone through a lot of this brand analysis. You've been a huge integral part of creating who the Grit is, obviously with the team and with everyone helping. For somebody that's trying to discover who they are, right? The individual that's trying to create their own brand, right? Whether it's in the summer sales space, whatever it may be, and they're trying to build that brand up on Instagram, on TikTok, whatever it may be, what advice would you give to them to find their brand and what works for them?
Yeah, I think that's a very important, relevant question. I think it's like someone who ignores their personal brand is just such a big fail.
Yeah.
And I imagine also a lot of people are probably like know that in their heads, but they're like, what do I have to say? Like, what do I have to offer actually? I and this isn't just like a feel good comment that I'm going to say. I believe that everyone like has something that they could take and push further, you know, and it's hard to, so I think the process for everybody would be like finding out what that is and through iteration. And so, you know, there's, a book that's red, but I forgot what it's called, but it's red and the artist's way maybe. But this woman, she was basically a therapist for artists. She would help them get out of creative blocks. One thing that she would have people do as part of this 6-week thing. And she was like the best, you know, because if you're a musician or an actor or a writer and you need like, creative blocks are real and you need to like to pay the bills or to continue to be creative, like that's a big deal, right? And so she would go and people would pay her so much money and they would go and she would like solve that. And what she says in her book is that, you know, one of the practices is called morning pages. And for 15 minutes when you wake up, just free write, just start a timer. You can, and a lot of the times you won't even want to be writing and that's okay. Just say that, be like, I don't want to be typing right now. You know, this is not what I want to do, but I'm supposed to do it. And it's just boring. But eventually you'll get past similarly those first ideas and you'll realize that you actually have a lot to say. Your subconscious is always going, but it's about like connecting with it. And so I think that everyone could, if they found out, if they ignored a template and ignored the voice that said, I don't have anything to say, or I don't have any unique identity, and really like push themselves to find, you know, what they're interested in or who they are, or, you know, maybe even like gathered information on, ask people like, who am I to you? Like, yeah. How do I make your life better to a close friend or a spouse, and getting those answers and be like, how can I start to like, to share that? How can I start to amplify my strengths and my message and my interests? But ultimately I think that will pay off in a huge, huge way.
Love that.
We've been inspired. We've been uplifted.
I actually am.
We've got.
I'm life. Actually inspired right now.
Me too. I think I'm in a morning write.
You got to do it.
I think
it'd
do well by me.
Yeah, you do it totally.
I'm certainly more likely to free write than do a Murph. So, I think I identify more with the creatives there. Well, Jake, we love you. I like can't overstate enough how much we value you at the company as a friend. You're the best.
Yeah.
Thanks for taking the time to be on the pad.
So grateful to be here.
Yeah, we love you.
We'll have to run it back. But as for right now, for this episode of The Landing Pad, we out.